resistance is futile.
Boldly going where no show has gone before. This is the Week in Geek with David D. Squared, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Broadcasting from the Gregory Ricks and Associates Wealth Management Studios, here's D. Squared.
Greetings, people of Earth. This is the Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I am your host, D. Squared. Let me lay out the show for you. We are jam-packed tonight. I fired Scungy because I got three guests tonight. We're going to kick it all up with Paul Hetherington, the Lego Brick Baron. He was here in town last week for the Brick Universe out in the Pontchartrain Center in Kennebra, but we didn't have time last week, so we hooked up this week, and we'll play that interview tonight. He's up there in Vancouver, and it's going to tie in. I'm bringing it back to Vancouver before we go to break in our top nerd news, but paulhetheringtonartist.com, that'll be our first guest. Then we have Stephen Kurczy. He wrote this new book called The Quiet Zone. It's about a little small town called Greenbank, Virginia, and it is the world's only radio-free zone. Now, it's not just radio. You can't have a cell phone. You can't have internet or Wi-Fi in this place because there is one of the only telescopic radio wave doomaflachy thingies where they're trying to find extraterrestrials. And if you have Wi-Fi, it messes up those signals as we, you know, get, you know, quasars and microwave beams from like the Crab Nebula. You get what I'm saying? But the weird part is because most people have tried to cast off the shackles of their social media and go back to the land, it attracts a lot of weirdos. And apparently, white supremacists get attracted to this small place. I guess because they figure the government can't watch it. Wrong. But a whole lot of weird stuff goes on there. Unsolved mysteries. It's crazy. We're going to talk with Stephen Kurczy after we talk with Paul Hetherington. I'll just give you a little hint about Stephen Kurczy. The dude ain't had a cell phone in 10 years. Let that sink in. Not even a freaking Nokia brick. He's just not had a cell phone. And then finally, we're going to wrap it all up with the son of legendary, visionary creator of Star Trek, Gene Roddenberry's son, Rod Roddenberry, will join us. And a big shout out to my boy Randolph Allen over there at USS New Orleans, because we asked him if he would go sign the petition for the Sisko Monument, change.org Sisko Monument. Go, you know, Google it, find it, go sign the dang thing. I have to point blank ask him, and he kind of dodges and evades, you know, dip, dodge, deep, dive, duck, whatever. That's all coming up tonight. But first, let's do this.
And now, your top nerd news stories from around the world, brought to you by the Viridian Tea Company. Find them on Etsy. And now, your top nerd news stories.
All right, so we got a new Eternals trailer. The, you know, the next Marvel movie coming out, November 5th is when this comes out. The Eternals, like, I don't know diddly about the Eternals. I've been having to read up and bone up on a whole bunch of stuff to try to figure out what the hell they are. But I will say this. Pause for dramatic effect and then forget what you're going to say. Rob Stark, the guy who's playing some guy in this movie, The Eternals, he's not Superman, okay? Everybody keeps saying he's Superman. A, Superman doesn't have a British accent because he's from Kansas. But also, just because he shoots freaking laser beams out of his eyes and he can fly and he's super strong does not make him Superman. Stop drawing those equations there, okay? Now here, listen to this.
5 years ago, Thanos erased half of the population of the universe.
Thanos.
But the people of this planet brought everyone back with a snap of a finger. The sudden return of the population provided the necessary energy for the emergence to begin.
We'll talk about the emergency. Emergence after this.
How long do we have?
7 days.
Oh, 7 days!
We're Eternals. We
came here 7,000 years ago to protect humans from the deviants.
Why didn't you guys help fight Thanos? Or any war, or all the other terrible things throughout history?
We were instructed not to interfere in any human conflicts unless deviants are involved.
Y'all suck.
Who? We need to find the others.
I haven't seen some of them for centuries.
Yeah, you've barely
this
been slacking.
What the world looks like. At least we have front row seats.
You know what's never saved the planet? Your sarcasm.
I like
this guy. We've loved these people since the day we arrived. When you love something,
set it free.
You protect it.
Oh,
you can't protect any of them.
Now he's shooting laser beams out of his eyes.
I bet you've built the perfect safe house.
Well, what's this even made of? Vibranium?
Fall collection. IKEA.
Getcha. All right, so here's the thing. The Deviants are the reason that the Eternals were here and they're fighting them. The Deviants went to war with the with Atlantis. They got sucked into the Earth. So they're like, I don't know, they're in the Hollow Earth, wherever the hell they're at. But the other side of that coin is the Celestials that created them. The Emergence, what the hell is the Emergence? Apparently, the blip and then the snap has given enough cosmic power to either piss off the Celestials that they're going to come here and judge Earth, or more likely, the Deviants will bust free out of their jail, emerge from the planet, and go to war with the Eternals. But you know what? I already dislike the Eternals. You slackers, man. You have failed us on every level. Poignant questions. Where were you when Thanos was around? What have you been doing? Hanging out on the moon. That's what you've been doing. Hanging out on the moon. You know, we'd have better chance if we had to fight aliens just like this.
Well, that's great. Now what the f*** are we supposed to do? We're some real pretty s*** now, man.
Damn, man.
He's
finished.
Man. Game over, man.
Game over,
game
man.
Over.
You know
what?
We're going to go buy Nerf blasters for $94.99. The Nerf Limited Aliens M41A blaster. You can now pre-order this bad boy here in America or in the UK for $94.99. All right, look, you can go to our Facebook page, facebook.com/TheWeekInGeek, and we have the link up there. I make zero money out of this. This is just because it's freaking awesome. And if you want a Nerf gun that's straight out of Aliens, game over, man. Go get you one. It's even got a cool digital counter. Like when you run out of Nerf bullets, it's just straight out of the movies. You won't get shot because it's bright yellow and white. And so it doesn't look, but you can always buy spray paint, just letting you know. But it looks totally awesome, and for $100, look, I just bought a Taysom Hill jersey for $150, you know? I make poor decisions, and, you know, we all have some disposable income that we probably should not dispose of, but I digress. There you go. Go get yourself a Nerf Limited M41A blaster from the movie Aliens. All right, before we go to break, I got some bad news to give you guys. Contraflow has been canceled. This sucks balls, I know. We were going to, you know, do our Irish wake for our dear departed friend Brian, but Contraflow, this is part of the press release that they put out. Due to the recent Delta variant, surge is not yet peaking in our region, and after working with and looking at all of our options with the host hotel, city, parish, state leadership, the board of directors of Contraflow has come to the following conclusion. We must once again postpone/reschedule Contraflow 10. Pandemic conditions and restrictions as they currently are and will be for the foreseeable future make it next to impossible to host a convention. They are rescheduling it for next year, October 7th through the 9th, 2022. And if you have already gotten your badges or dealer's tables, you can contact them at info@contraflowscifi.org. But also it rolls over. But finally, if you did get a hotel room, you can go to Hilton New Orleans Airport Hotel and then scroll down, click on additional hotel policies, look for cancellation. I know it sucks. And look, you know, let me just give you this little image in your head. They were going to turn the room party floor into the life of Brian in honor of our dear departed friend. We're all going to be drinking in close quarters. Nobody's going to be wearing a mask. It is literally a super spreader event, you know, and we all got comorbidities. We're all a little hefty in the convention circuit. Y'all know what I'm getting at. So this is it's a crappy thing, but it is what it is. There's not a whole lot we can do about it. So it sucks, but Contraflow will now be October 7th to the 9th in the year of our Lord 2022. I know it sucks. Now, I'll leave you with the Vancouver connection. Oh, God, that's really loud. So, Ryan Reynolds, Van City Reynolds, if you have not heard, okay, stop talking Reading Rainbow Lady. All right, so if you don't know, the host for Jeopardy got canned because he's you know, not a nice fella. And Mayim Bialik is probably, you know, Blossom, probably going to be the new host. But we all want LeVar Burton. And Ryan Reynolds tweeted this out pretty consistently from 2013 to 2015. Deadpool would explode on Twitter with fans wanting me to play him. It was awkward because I agreed with them, but the studio didn't see it. Ultimately, the fans won, and the rest is glorious history. Hi, LeVar Burton. And LeVar Burton just said, happy Friday, y'all. He needs to be the next Jeopardy host. And so, how do I make the Van City connection, Vancouver? Because, wait, that wrong thing. Here we go. Reading Rainbow, get lady, get back in here. Start singing. Our next guest, Paul Hetherington, paulhetheringtonartist.com is coming up next. He's straight out of Vancouver. This is The Week in Geek on News Talk 99.5 WRNO.
And ways to grow a reading rainbow. I can be anything.
Box tea again? Why don't you try the tea blends from the Viridian Tea Company? They sell blends that are guaranteed to make you think outside the box. With blends like Quantum Mechanics, Caligula's Herbal Nerve Tonic, and Manta Ray Dreaming, your tea experience will be out of this world. Look for the blends at Tubby & Coos Mid-City Bookshop at 432 North Anthony Street or online at Etsy at the Viridian Tea Company. So put down the box and order some tea from the Viridian Tea Company today. Sincerely, your taste buds.
Welcome back to The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Don't forget, you can listen to previous episodes on the iHeartRadio app at The Week in Geek Radio Show. Here's D Squared.
Welcome back in to The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I am your host, D Squared. Let's go to the guest line. Last Sunday, I got a chance to see a whole lot of Lego masterpieces, and we weren't able to connect during the show last Sunday, so I brought him on this week. Lego artist Paul Hetherington joins us. Paul, how are you doing today, sir?
Oh, I'm great. Thanks so much for having me on the show.
Man, look, I'm excited, dude. It's crazy. Like, with COVID now, you can't always do, like, recorded or live interviews as well because everybody's wearing a mask, and then, you know, you're at an event, so it's kind of hard with all the ambient background noise. So I'm like, you know what? Let's just hook up later. So now here we are. Brick Universe was last week, but one of the reasons I wanted to have you on is because this is a nerdy kind of show, and a lot of your pieces I really loved. You had some Doctor Who stuff, you had Batman, you had Scooby-Doo, all steampunk. So first off, Paul, tell the folks a little bit about yourself, where you're from, and how you got into Legos, man.
Oh, sure. Yeah, this is actually my 30th anniversary of being into Lego as an adult. When I was about 21, I bought a little Lego space set, and this was way before the internet and before, you know, there was Lego clubs and Lego was like a cool thing.
Right.
In fact, I remember the first set I bought, the cashier kind of looked at me strange, like, who are you buying that for, you know? So things have changed a lot because now Lego, you know, markets a lot of the sets to adults. There's like $500 sets and, you know, some of them are pretty intense builds. But basically from there, I started collecting it for fun. And then over time, you know, with the Lego clubs, I joined my local Lego club in Vancouver, Canada, where I'm from. And, started going to conventions, and that's really what kickstarted me into building these big creations.
Now, you know, one of the things that I when I was checking up on you, doing some research for the interview, I saw that you have in one of the Lego house, the home of the brick, they have exhibitors from all across the world, and some of your work is on display there. Tell me what you got in the house of the brick, man.
Yeah, that was an amazing experience. Back in 2019, I got invited to the Masterpiece Gallery, which is like kind of the top room in the Lego house. It's the one with these three giant Lego dinosaurs. and then they have display cases around the walls, and they invite 12 people from around the world every year to display their creations there. So it's kind of like getting the Lego golden ticket.
Nice.
And I have a piece there called We Built This City. I made it specifically for that, and it's a super colorful city that shows a robot building the city, and the robot is kind of like one of those Japanese animation ones, and on the chest, instead of all the controls, it says it's on step number 8,168 or something like that.
That's awesome. Paul Hetherington is our guest, Lego builder extraordinaire. Now, look, one of the things that I was impressed by was, and with all the exhibits out there, I was intrigued by the number of bricks per display, but also the hours to take. But one thing that I'd never really thought of until I saw it printed on one of the cards was time spent developing and designing it. How do you go about designing this? Are there computer programs? Is it just pen and paper? How do you design some of your creations, man?
Ah, good question. So you want my secrets?
The reason I'm asking, though, seriously, the reason I'm asking, though, is because when I went with my 15-year-old and my 8-year-old. And look, yeah. I was first off, I was kind of shocked that my 15-year-old wanted to go at first. But, I mean, he really is a fan of building some of the larger things. Like, we're Star Wars nerds over here at my house. And so he built Darth Vader's Mustafar thing, which is a really tall, kick-ass set. And those are the things that he likes to build. My little 8-year-old just likes to, play with the minifigs. But the designing thing, I'm interested in it because maybe if there's like a cool program out there, maybe I'd buy it for my kid and let him start designing stuff. Because honestly, it's a great tool for just like education, architecture. I like the medium, and I think it would be great for kids. So that's kind of where my question's coming from, Paul.
Yeah, no, I know. I was just kidding around. Well, first, it's cool that, being 15 now, Lego is still cool. So they've kind of bridged that gap where you don't really have to have your dark ages where, when I was 11, you got into other things and Lego just wasn't cool. But now, obviously, it's got all the license. But yeah, as far as creating them, I get a vision in my head of what I want to create. And just having collected Lego for 30 years, I have a whole bunch of bricks lying around. If you do mosaics and things like that, you can use programs, online programs. I know Legoland, will take an image and then put it into their program, and it'll so they do most of their sculptures this way where, they'll like scan in a giant Poseidon, and then the program will pop out a kind of a layer by layer, imprint of
really?
Yeah.
That's
awesome. But your average Joe on the street, I don't think we really have access to that. There might be a few out there now.
Mm-hmm.
But for me personally, it's very organic. I just do it, in my head and just really start putting the bricks in and put in the time to create what I'm seeing in my head.
We're visiting with artist Paul Hetherington. Find him at paulhetheringtonartist.com. Why? Are you a nerd, man? I mean, because like with the Batman and the Joker and then the Doctor Who stuff, is that kind of like your wheelhouse or what, man?
Yeah, well, I come from like a toy collecting background, so
okay.
Even before I was buying Lego, but really I was I was collecting Hot Wheels and like a lot of the 70s action figures, like the Marvel superhero line by Mego and all those, so. you know, that's kind of, I mean, Batman, for me personally, it's the Joker. I always build from the Joker's perspective because he's a little more colorful.
Nice.
You know, Batman's just, you know, his foil. Batman's cool, but I don't know if I'd personally ever build a Batcave because, well, partly because so many people have done it, you know, so well. But yeah, definitely nerd material here. That's for sure.
Now tell me about the steampunk thing, because I've seen that on a lot of promotional material too. Where did that come from? How did you make that? How'd that work?
Okay, that one came out of my imagination. I mean, initially I was inspired by I had a steampunk calendar, you know,
okay.
And that's kind of my thing. I'll buy a calendar every year from an artist that I like, and then, you know, I'll get inspired by it. But that particular robot is my own creation. But how that came about was I had been hoarding silver and gold parts, which were kind of new at the time. This was going back about 5 years.
Okay.
And after a while of like collecting as many different interesting parts as I could, I was like, what can I, you know, use these chrome and gold parts for? And well, a robot seemed to be the logical choice. So that's how that one came about.
That's cool, man. Paul Hetherington is our guest now. Brick Universe just happened last week. Now, this is, y'all go on tour a lot. Like, I mean, I know y'all got a bunch of cities, like 12 stops or something like that. How do you transport those things? Because my son and I were kind of scratching our head. It's just like, I know y'all ain't rebuilding it. So do y'all like chop it into pieces? How do y'all transport them, man?
Yeah, there's a bit of an art to that. I grew up designing these to go to Lego conventions, you know, not usually in my own city. You know, we're in Vancouver, so we'd go to BrickCon or Bricks Cascade, which are in Seattle and Portland, respectively, there. So, you know, I'd have to fit them into my little station wagon, and so they were all designed to break into sections. So you don't necessarily take everything apart, but, right, you know, like a large creation might break into, say, 5 or 6 sections that you put into cardboard boxes. And in the case of Brick Universe, we took those cardboard boxes, then we just made a larger wooden crate, and we put them in there. And then we just shipped the crate from city to city.
So how long does it maybe take you to rebuild them once they get on site? Because, I mean, look, I've built my fair share of Lego things in the past, and sometimes they just don't want to cooperate, and they fall apart. Like, I've never been more mad when I was building a car one time, and the frame of it broke, and I basically had to start over from scratch. I mean, talk about patience, man. But how long does it take y'all to reset that stuff back up?
I mean, usually our setup day, I feel like I'm a Lego roadie. So it takes about, for my gallery, about 8 hours to do, you know, and that goes from like open up the crates, and then you got to get all the boxes to the respective tables where you want to set up your creation. Then you got to take everything out of the boxes and then reassemble the parts. And yeah, invariably, you know, a couple, you know, will possibly have suffered some battle damage during the trip.
Right.
Depending on the quality of the roads in the state that we're in.
Oh, well, you must have spent 20 hours rebuilding that, because we got crap roads here, man.
Yeah, there was a few casualties this time, but, you know, it's all part of the fun, and it is interesting sometimes when I have to try and rebuild something that I made 10 years before.
Oh,
I'm like,
God.
How did I make this? You know,
it's awesome. But like, wait, where did this go? Is it like, yeah, when you're fixing a car, there's always a few pieces left over. It's like, wait, what does this go to? Do I still need this?
That is exactly it. Every time I repair something, there is always 5 or 6 extra parts. So, you know, the more they break, the more efficient they become.
There you go. Paul Hetherington is our guest. Now, Paul, obviously, you know, you have to eat. Now, how do people, how do you get commissions? How do you take commissions? You know, how can people, you know, get something made of, and how do you work commissions? Do they give you an idea and then you create it? Or do they say like, hey, I specifically want like a 57 Chevy or something like that?
Yeah, pretty much that's exactly how it works. You know, people can contact me through the website, paulhetheringtonartist.com, to send me a message, or through social media. You know, I'm on Instagram and Facebook. And but yeah, I mean, well, you probably saw the little Prince concert that I had at the show on. And that was a commission. A really nice lady in Pennsylvania who was a massive Prince fan contacted me and you know. That was a dream commission for me because I'm a huge Prince fan, and you know, I have been since the 1980s. So, you know, I already knew, like, I could just picture it right away.
Right.
And then, you know, I've done recently for a university professor, I built the inside of a Linacad machine, which is like, I think they use it for cancer treatment. Okay. You know, it's kind of like the radiation type thing. And he wanted to have a Lego model that would show his students how the processes work inside, which we used kind of using a flashlight and then directing the light through different areas of the Lego creation. So there's really no limit to what you can do. And yeah, I'm always open to suggestions. People can contact me and I'll build whatever you need.
That is pretty cool, man. That is Paul Hetherington. Paul, look, thank you so much for your time. Go to paulhetheringtonartist.com, commission to do some work for you. And where are you off to next? What exotic locale is next for Paul Hetherington?
Oh, well, first we got to go home to Vancouver. We're in New Orleans still right now. And then we're going to St. Louis and I think Jackson, Mississippi. We're going to Raleigh, okay, North Carolina, where Brick Universe started. So we've got a whole bunch of cities coming up. And especially going into 2022, we have a lot of big plans.
There you go. That is Paul Hetherington. Paul, look, thank you so much for your time tonight. I really do appreciate it. And have fun out there making Legos, man.
Oh, thank you so much.
All right, coming up next, we have author Stephen Kurczy of The Quiet Zone. It's a nonfiction, real-life book, and there's a town here in America where you can't have a cell phone, you can't have Wi-Fi, you can disconnect and be one with the land. Cast off the shackles of social media. Be free! Or not be surrounded by a bunch of weirdos who are trying to do the same thing. Gets a little wacky out there in Green Bank, Virginia. So that's coming up next right here on The Week in Geek on News Talk 99.5 WRNO. What do you get the nerd who has everything? A gift card from D4 Tabletop Gaming Cafe, and let them figure it out. D4 Tabletop Gaming Cafe at 8228 Oak Street is open for the holidays, so head over and check out their expanded inventory of miniatures and miniature paints, board games, RPGs, TCGs. Or you can reserve a table for your next game night. Find them on Facebook at D4 Tabletop Gaming Cafe, or go to their location at 8228 Oak Street, just two blocks off of Carrollton. Or go to their website at d4cafe.biz.
Now back to The Week in Geek with D Squared. Tell your friends, tell your enemies. Yeah, definitely tell your enemies.
Welcome back into The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D Squared. Let's go to the guest line. Author of the new book, Quiet Zone, about a city where cell phones and Wi-Fi are outlawed, Stephen Kurczy joins us. Stephen, how are you doing today, man?
I'm okay. It's great to be talking with you.
So look, talk to me about this book. Now, this is a work of nonfiction. This is straight from Americana itself in Green Bank, West Virginia, right?
It's all true. It's all a true story. It's one of the craziest stories I've ever walked into, which is why it just had to be a book.
Now, I guess explain to people, why is it a Wi-Fi free zone? Because there's an astronomy lab there, right?
Yeah, so it's not quite a Wi-Fi free zone. It's a quiet zone, and what that actually means becomes like a large part of like what I'm exploring. And what does it mean to live in a quiet zone? And can you actually have Wi-Fi there or not? It's a quiet zone because of a famous radio astronomy observatory, the Green Bank Astronomy Observatory, our country's very first federal radio astronomy observatory. Radio astronomy measures radio waves coming in from outer space, measuring cosmic events from pulsars and intergalactic explosions and colliding black holes and such. And you can't do that radio astronomy work if you're in a noisy environment. So it's got to be a quiet zone. And so there's been a state law and also a federal law passed by U.S. Congress back in 1958, which mandates that this area shall remain quiet. And you can't have certain electronics. You can't emit certain electromagnetic frequencies that might interfere with those telescopes.
Now, apparently, though, that's not always the case, though, right? They got a guy named Chuck who tools around town looking for people that are breaking the law with their Wi-Fi, and then some people just get busted. It's like, nope, I don't have any Wi-Fi. What you talking about, man?
Yeah, so the observatory has existed since 1956, and things have changed a lot since then. Back in 56, we didn't have cell service, Wi-Fi, smartphones. We didn't have, this Internet of Things making Wi-Fi in our car tires and our laundry detergent. So that's a new phenomenon that the observatory has had to deal with. It used to be the case that people weren't knowingly bringing in these electronics that would interfere. Interference might just be caused by a malfunctioning FAM/FM radio. And so Chuck's predecessor, a guy named Wesley, might roll up with his truck outside of your house and say, "Hey, I'm picking up interference from your house. Can I check it out? Can I fix your radio? Can I fix your fence? Can I fix your TV?" And he would fix it, and the source would be fixed. It would go away. But now Chuck, he's like the replacement for Wesley since Wesley's retirement, and Chuck is finding less willingness of people to play along with keeping the area quiet. And people are more willing to like hide their Wi-Fi, deny they have Wi-Fi, or just say, "Screw you, Chuck, I'm going to have Wi-Fi whether or not you like it."
America! Stephen Kurczy.
Yeah, yeah.
Stephen Kurczy is our guest, author of Quiet Zone. Now, look, this kind of shocked the crap out of me, dude. So, like you're I'm not going to call you a Luddite, but you are not a fan of cell phones, and you ditched the phone kind of making a pilgrimage here to Green Bank in the search that, others, like-minded individuals would have, cast off the chains of social media and their cell phones. But you found something completely different once you got there, huh?
That's a great way of putting it. Back in 2009, I threw away my very first and last cell phone. I have not owned a cell phone since then. Initially, it was a decision to save some money. And since then, it's become like this obstinate refusal to have a device that everybody is telling me I have to have, from family and friends to employers telling me to be connected all the time so they can reach me whenever they want to, so that my boss can, ask me at 9 o'clock at night to look at something, for work, which I believe I just shouldn't have to. I shouldn't have to be always connected for the sake of other people. I want to be more in charge of these devices and when I want to be online.
I appreciate your principles. I appreciate that. But most people don't stick to those principles. So good on you, Stephen.
Yeah, I think everybody does feel a sense of like overload, right? And we all do feel this annoyance from these devices. It might be from a person at the movie theater who's like looking at their device or talking on their phone during a movie. It's like, God, can't you just put it away? And like, we have moments like this in our lives. Time where we weren't always on our devices, but we could break free of these things. And those questions are really what led me to Green Bank in search of maybe there is a place where we can get away from it all.
Now, this is the other thing that kind of blew me away. This is a work of nonfiction. I just want to hammer this point home. This is reality, nonfiction. Nonfiction. Now, look, so when you got there, though, you found that some people were kind of squirreling away some of their cell phones, but also just like this strange cast of characters. You've got, hippies and Back to the Landers. You got the Patch Adams guy who was based off of, or he is the model of the movie Patch Adams. But then you had white supremacist William Pierce, and then the electrosensitive. There's a lot of crazy stuff going on over there in Green Bank, huh, man?
I mean, at one point, to give you a sense of the craziness, I found myself deep inside a cave where an unsolved murder happened back in 1975. And I was with both one of those neo-Nazis as well as this, drug-dealing ex-convict who was the son of the man suspected of being behind that murder back in 1975. And here I am deep inside this cave. Nobody knows where I am. I'm finally finding myself in a place of absolute, utter silence and radio quiet. And it was this most terrifying moment of all my reporting there.
Are you a crazy person, Stephen? I mean, my God, you go to a cave without any sort of protection, not even your phone. Oh my God, that just cracks me up, dude. So, all right, so tell me about the electrosensitives, though, because this is something where, look, People have phobias, people have actual physical things. Just because they might not be in a medical journal doesn't mean that it's not real. But there's a lot of folks out there that are claiming to be extremely sensitive and get ill from, Wi-Fi or radio waves, et cetera, right? Tell me about that.
That's right. There are many people worldwide, and some really notable celebrities and public officials have said that they believe that they are physically harmed by Wi-Fi, by cell service, by lots of this modern gadgetry that's causing radio noise in all of our lives. And hundreds of them have come to Green Bank, to the quiet zone, because they believe that it's their last refuge in the noisy world. They believe this is the last place where they can get away from cell towers and Wi-Fi and certain electric ovens and microwaves. They think this is the last place where they can feel free from that pain. And so they have become really important allies to the Radio Astronomy Observatory, because they're all fighting for this area to remain quiet. And they don't want that Wi-Fi coming in, or that cell service coming in, or people be carrying cell phones. So like, you have this kind of strange alliance happening between these outsiders with this kind of dubious illness that we're not really sure what to make of. But then with this super high-tech astronomy observatory, which is at the forefront of doing this groundbreaking astronomy work.
That's insane. Stephen Kurczy is our guest. Quiet Zone is out now. Stephen, look, thank you so much for your time. I really do appreciate it. And I guess one final thing. Does the Illuminati run Green Bank? Is that what's going on, though?
You'll have to read the book to find out.
Nicely played. Stephen, thank you so much for your time today, man. I really do appreciate it.
Thank you, David.
All right. Alrighty then, coming up next, the son of the creator of Star Trek, Gene Roddenberry's son, Rod Roddenberry, is going to join us next to talk about hashtag Think Trek. Alright, sorry, music distracts me. Alright, so, Rod is coming up next. We're going to talk about 100 days, 100 thoughts of Gene Roddenberry, because it would have been Gene Roddenberry's 100th birthday. And to help us talk about it, I also, thanks to my boy Randolph Allen, I asked him to sign the change.org petition to get the Sisko Monument here in New Orleans. So, I don't know. He was a little cagey about it. So, stick around. That's all coming up next, right here on The Week in Geek on News Talk 99.5 WRNO. Hey y'all, D Squared here, and I'm joined by a special guest, the Go Forblin, to bring you a special announcement. That's right. Go Four Games, your friendly neighborhood game shop since 2010, is moving to 4953 West Napoleon Avenue in the Napoleon Plaza. Keep up to date with the move and Go Forblin's adventure on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Go Four Games NOLA and GoForGamesNOLA.com. What's that? Oh, he says he can't wait for you to see his new pick of location at 4953 West Napoleon Avenue.
This is Pinky of Pinky and the Brain. And when Brain and I are not planning to take over the world, which is pretty much never, but when that happens, the only show we listen to, or rather the only show Brain allows me to listen to, is The Week in Geek on WRNO. Nerd!
Welcome back into The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D Squared. Now, as always, I want to strongly urge you to check out the Facebook page, facebook.com/ The Week in Geek. Check out our website or not at twigradio.com. Follow us on Twitter at Twig Radio and the Instagrams, The Week in Geek. Now, you can always check out old shows or download this podcast at Spreaker.com, Stitcher, Spotify, or on YouTube. And, of course, the iHeartRadio app. Wherever podcasts are freely given away, you will find The Week in Geek. Now, let's go to the guest line. Executive producer of quite a few Star Trek series and son of the late great visionary Gene Roddenberry, Rod Roddenberry joins us. Rod, how are you doing today, man?
I'm doing amazing. Thank you so much for having me on here.
So look, let's talk about this year-long kickoff of what would have been your father's 100th birthday with hashtag Think Trek. Tell me about it, bud.
Yeah, I'm so excited. My father was a visionary. He lived in the future. He knew that 100 years ago, there were things that were absurd and crazy that today are commonplace. He lived 100 years from now. What seems absurd to us today? What does not seem commonplace? What seems that, whether it's government, politics, religion, sex, marriage, you name it, he said these things will be easier to deal with in the future, and we all need to sort of put our differences aside, not just put them aside, but realize that it's the craving and thirsting for things that are different that will help us grow and evolve as a species. So the campaign that we've done is we've gone through all of his speeches, all of his writings. We've taken out 100 quotes, and we wanted to put them out there with celebrities. We've had a lot of prolific people from the Star Trek realm. We've got people from the science realm. They're sharing these. We've also launched a podcast where we've got two great hosts and a guest. They look into these quotes. They talk about them. It's been quite mind-expanding to be a part of this and hear what's going on.
Now, you're talking about finding your dad's old speeches and things like that. There was a quite a few recordings of him. Could we maybe yep. say that perhaps he was like the father of podcasting almost?
I haven't thought of it that way, but yeah. I mean, I'll let you say that.
All right. Well, let's hashtag Think Trek. I mean, you've got a bevy of celebrities, but it's also talking about things that inspired you, because there's other ways you can get involved by hashtagging Think Trek, but like also things you see around the world that make you think mm-hmm. of Star Trek. And I guess, how does all that play in?
Well, of course, if you go out right now and you look at hashtag Think Trek, you'll see incredible photos that people have put out there and ideas. Some of them are fun. Some of them are thoughtful. The idea is to get people to keep Star Trek on the mind, not because it's fun science fiction, but because Star Trek speaks to us. It was speaking to us in the 60s. It was telling us that we needed to get our act together and come together for a better future. You know what? We need that today just as much. So the true appreciation of things that are different is what will help us grow as a species. If we don't do that, we're not going to move forward.
So now we're visiting with Rod Roddenberry. Think Trek. Go to Roddenberry.com /Think Trek. Now, you know, you're executive producer on a lot of these new Star Trek series that are out. And I got to say, man, like Star Trek Discovery and the original series with the Mirror Mirror episode, how much... I guess I'm always curious as to what your father might have been thinking with that, because it was always such... People just think about Spock with a goatee, but there's a lot more. There's a lot of deeper things in there with that, like the barbarians, because I remember the quote at the end was how it was easy for civilized men to behave like barbarians, but the opposite for barbarians to act like civilized people.
Yeah, that's incredibly well said, and I absolutely love that quote. You know, Star Trek used a lot of metaphors in the 60s, late 60s to get its messages out. They're visual metaphors. You know, the planets they lived on or they went to, or the situations they were in were definitely sci-fi in nature, but it was to show us a reflection of ourselves and sometimes the ugly side of ourselves, and then point the actors at that and say, how absurd is that to behave in that way? And look how this culture and society is being stunted and halted because they are acting, well, dare I say, in an absurd behavior. So having that message, having all the young people of the day kind of latch onto that and really pushing for us to hopefully end wars and end conflict and end discrimination, that's critical. And again, it was relevant then. We need that now. We absolutely need that now.
Well, you know, a good friend of mine, Randolph Allen, he is the captain of the USS New Orleans, Starship New Orleans. And, you know, Benjamin Sisko, he was the first captain, person of color, to helm the show. But also, you know, you've got monuments to where James T. Kirk was born, where Captain Janeway was born. And we are working, well, I can't say we, Randolph is working on a change.org petition to get a monument to Captain Ben Sisko here in New Orleans, because that's where we are, and we don't have one, man. Can you help us get that done?
I don't know what I can do, but I'm in full support of it. And trust me, anyone who's got geek out there, I'm happy to encourage and support the geek. You guys are just thinking about a better future, and you're doing something that inspires others. So absolutely.
Well, just go sign the petition when you get a chance. Now, once again, Think Trek, hashtag Think Trek. It's a year long, and it's 100 quotes. So it's kind of like, you know, like a word of the day, but like but more than just mm-hmm. a kiddie poster hang in there. You know, like what's probably your favoritest quote? Favoritest, that's not a word, but your most favorite quote that you know, is in this year long thing.
I am going to butcher it. I'm going to see if I can even do it. He's talking about the Star Trek audience in this quote, and he says that, you know, our audience out there, they're sick of their petty governments and visionist leaders They have a thirst and craving for a better future, and they need that now. And he was really just saying the people that he's met, the fans that love Star Trek, these are the ones who are our thought leaders today, and they are the ones who can guide us in the right direction for a better and more united future.
That is amazing. Rod Roddenberry is, I guess, son of the visionary Gene Roddenberry, creator of Star Trek. And I guess, you know, one final thing before we kind of wrap up here. You're also an executive producer on the, like, Star Trek Discovery, Lower Decks. And something that I got to say, man, look, I really love Star Trek Discovery, because one of the things that I felt that it did well was that it sort of spoiler alert to everybody, but when she jumps into the future and the Federation is destroyed and just scattered across the diaspora of the galaxy, they come in, and this show does a great job of saying, hey, we need this Federation and getting together as much as possible. And I love that they're running around trying to rebuild the Federation. Where did that come from, and where can we expect more of that coming into Star Trek Discovery?
Well, there's an incredibly talented team of developers, writers, and creators over at Secret Hideout, run under Alex Kurtzman. They have the part you just mentioned was season 3 of Star Trek Discovery. They've got an incredible season 4 on the way. It is important for everyone when they work on this show. They're to do it not for a paycheck. They're doing it because they know Star Trek means something, and they want to make sure those ideals are in Star Trek and they continue to inspire people. So they are creating great content that entertains by all means, but every now and then slips in a message or two. That's why I'm here. That's why I love Trek.
That is Rod Roddenberry. Go to Roddenberry.com/thinktrek. 100 quotes for 100 days. I keep saying a year, but maybe let's just make it a year anyway. Rod, thank you so much for your time today. I really do appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me, and live long and prosper.
Amen to that, bro. And there you go. That is Rod Roddenberry. Go to Roddenberry.com or follow them on Twitter. Or, like I was trying to get him to do, but he kind of, moved past it before I could really kind of, I only got a short window of time. Sorry, Randolph. But, I mean, I did ask him to go sign the change.org petition. But for you listeners out there that are interested in getting a Sisko Monument, go to change.org, Sisko Monument, S-I-S-K-O, Monument, Monument. That's how you spell it, Monument. So I want to thank all of our guests tonight. Paul Hetherington, go follow him at Lego Brick Baron on Twitter. Go to his website. Have him build some Legos for you, man. And, of course, Stephen Kurczy, a crazy man who goes in caves with crazy-er people, living the good life without a cell phone or social media. I could not do that. I don't know how he does it. Maybe it's the Illuminati. Maybe he's part of the Illuminati. You'll have to buy the book to find out. And, of course, Rod Roddenberry. Now, next week, I got a couple of people on the hook right now. The dad from The Nanny, Shaughnessy, I'm blanking on his first name. And then another fine actor who has been in Deadwood. He was also in The Mandalorian. We'll talk about all that next week. Now, before we get out of here, come on, David, get it together. There we go. As always, I want to strongly urge you to check out the Facebook page. Facebook.com/TheWeekInGeek. Check out our website, or Not Twig Radio. Follow us on Twitter at Twig Radio, and the Instagram's TheWeekInGeek. Download the podcast, Spreaker, Stitcher, Spotify. Go subscribe to us on the iHeartRadio app. That way you never miss a podcast. And we're on YouTube. We're everywhere. Wherever podcasts are freely given away, you will find The Weekend Geek. All right. Well, I guess we're not going to see each other in October. But, it's okay. It's okay. Just come here every Sunday night at 7 o'clock. Tell your friends. Tell your enemies. Till next time, keep your nerd flag raised high.